मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट इकोनॉमिक्स चैप्टर 2, पीपल एज रिसोर्स। स्टूडेंट्स, इन अवर लास्ट क्लास वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द स्टोरी ऑफ विलेज पालमपुर। नाउ वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट पीपल एज रिसोर्स। लेट अस डिस्कस अबाउट ह्यूमन रिसोर्स एंड ग्रोस नेशनल प्रोडक्ट। ह्यूमन रिसोर्सेस मीन्स ह्यूमन बीइंग्स हु आर हेल्थी, एजुकेटेड and mentally strong can prove to be useful for a country or community and are treated as resources themselves called human resources. Students, human resource is the ultimate resource. Healthy, educated and motivated people develop resources as per their requirements. Students, population is an asset for the economy rather than a liability. It becomes human capital when investments are made in its healthcare, training and education. Land and capital are made useful by human capital. That is why human capital is superior to other forms of capital. Students, working population of a country, their existing productive skills and abilities are known as people as resource, isn't it? Yes, this productive nature of population helps to develop the gross national product of a country through its abilities. So, it is also known as human resource. Students, what do you mean by gross national product? Yes, the total market value of all the goods and services produced by a citizen of a country, whether living at home or abroad, during a specific period. Students, when the existing human resources further developed by becoming more educated and healthy, we call it human capital formation. Students, what do you mean by people as a resource? Yes, people as a resource means people are an asset rather than a liability. Am I right? For example, the work population of a country. Students, when does population becomes human capital? Yes, population becomes human capital when investment is made in the form of education, training and medical care. It adds up to the productive power of a country. Students, what do you mean by gross national product? Yes, the total market value of all the goods and services produced by a nation or citizen of a country, whether living at home or abroad, during a specific period. Going on to understand investment in human capital. Students, investment in human capital through education, training and medical care yields a return just like investment in physical capital, isn't it? For example, more educated or better trained persons earn higher income because they give higher productivity to their employers. Students, in the same way, a healthier person can also give higher productivity and earn a good income, isn't it? Students, do you know population can be turned into a productive asset by spending resources on education and health for all, giving training to industrial and agricultural workers for using modern technology, providing useful scientific researches and so on. Students, how can investment be made in humans? Yes, investment can be made in humans by means of education, training and provision of healthcare facilities. Let us discuss about investment in education and health. Students, population can be turned into a productive asset by spending resources on education and health for all, isn't it? For example, educated parents are found to invest more heavily on the education of their children. They are also more aware of their children's needs of nutrition and hygiene. Students, a virtuous cycle is created in this case. Students, what do you mean by virtuous? Yes, having high moral standards. Countries like Japan have invested heavily in human resources because they did not have adequate natural resources, isn't it? Yes, they import the natural resources needed by the country. Students, they have invested on people, especially in the field of education and health. These people have made efficient use of other resources like land and capital. Students, efficiency and technology evolved by people have made these countries developed. Students, why do educated parents invest heavily in the education of their children? Yes, educated parents invest more in the health and education of their children because they are aware of the benefits of higher education. Students, in fact, human capital is in one way superior to other resources like land and physical capital. Human resource can make use of land and capital. Students, land and capital cannot become useful on its own. Listen to it. Students, human capital is superior to other resources because other resources can be developed only by human beings with their skills and knowledge. They cannot be developed and become useful on their own. Students, how is human capital superior to other resources? Yes, human capital is superior to other resources because other resources can be developed only by human beings with their skills and knowledge. They cannot be developed and become useful on their own. Moving on to understand economic activities. Students, economic activities means all humans perform a variety of activities on any given day. Listen to it. Yes, there is work that we do every day and other activities we do for personal fulfillment and joy. So, as a general rule, we can say that all the activities we do to earn a living are economic activities. All other activities are non-economic activities. Simply we can say the activities which help to earn money for the country or add value to the national income are known as economic activities. Students, activities which add value to the national income are called economic activities or market activities. The economic activities have been classified into three main sectors. They are primary sector, secondary sector and tertiary sector. First, we will discuss about primary sector. Students, primary sector means all activities which harvest or extract natural products from the earth or natural resources are classified in this category. Students, it produces goods by exploiting natural resources. Students, primary sector includes agriculture, forestry, animal husbandry, fishing, poultry farming, mining and quarrying. Students, what are the different types of primary activities? Yes, primary activities include agriculture, forestry, animal husbandry, mining, quarrying and poultry farming, etc. Let us discuss about secondary sector. Students, secondary sector means using products resulting from activities in the primary sector for manufacturing of finished goods are classified in this category. Isn't it? Students, it converts all raw materials into finished goods such as manufacturing industries and construction activities. Moving on to understand tertiary sector. Students, all activities which support the primary and secondary sectors are classified in this category. Listen to it. Yes. This includes trade, transportation, communication, sales and services, education, health, tourism, banking, insurance, legal services, and government, etc. Students, what are economic activities? Yes, the activities which help to earn money for the country or add value to the national income are known as economic activities. Let us discuss about market activities. Students, market activities are those activities for which the people who perform these activities are paid or have profits such as production of goods and services. That means these are those activities which involve remuneration to those who perform the activities for wages or profit. Students, do you know economic activities have two parts? They are market activities and non-market activities. Students, let us discuss about market activities. Students, these are those activities which involve remuneration to those who perform the activities for wages or profit. For example, production of goods or services, including government services. Students, what do you mean by market activities? Yes, market activities are those activities for which the people who perform these activities are paid or have profits, such as production of goods and services. Moving on to understand non-market activities. Students, non-market activities are those activities which are carried out for self-consumption, such as consumption and processing of primary products and own accounts production of fixed assets. That means non-market activities are the production of self-consumption. For example, women doing domestic work, looking after children are non-market activities. Isn't it? Yes. Can you tell what are non-market activities? Yes. Non-market activities are those activities which are carried out for self-consumption, such as consumption and processing of primary products and own account production of fixed assets. Moving on to understand economic activities by men and women. Students, due to historical and cultural reasons, there is a division of labor between men and women in the family. Students, women generally look after domestic works and men work in the fields, earning money which they spent on rearing their families or market activities. Students, women are not paid for their service delivered in the family because the household work done by women is not recognized in the national income. Students, this division of labor between men and women in families is due to historical and cultural reasons. Students, women are paid for their work when they enter the labor market. Their earning, like that of their male counterparts, determined on the basis of education and skill. Education helps individual to make better use of the economic opportunities available before him. Education and skill are the major determinants of the earning of any individual in the market. Students, a majority of women have meager education and low skill compared to men. Most women work in primary sector, which lacks job security, legal protection and provides irregular and low income. Students, do you know there is also absence of basic facilities like maternity leave, child care leave and other social security systems? Isn't it? Students, on the other hand, women with high education and skill are paid equally as men. Students, do you know in which case women get paid for their work? Yes, women are paid for their work when they enter into the labor market. Yes, education and skill are the two major determinants of earnings. Moving on to understand quality of population. Students, quality of population is the overall qualitative functioning of the population that signifies its social, economic and cultural growth and output. Students, do you know education and health are the most important factors affecting quality of population? Students, the quality of population depends upon the literacy rate, health of a person indicated by life expectancy and skill formation acquired by the people of the country. Let us discuss about education. Students, education opens new horizons, develops life values and gives rise to new aspirations. Students, what do you mean by horizons? Yes, the limit of a person's knowledge. Students, it increases the national income as well as the cultural richness and efficiency of governance. Vocational education has developed to provide skill-based education, which leads to ready employment. Students, there is provision made for providing universal access, retention and quality in elementary education, with a special emphasis on girls. Special schools called as Navodaya Vidyalaya have been established in each district. Students, Navodaya Vidyalayas are the schools started for talented children in the rural areas. Although government expenditure on education has increased enormously in the last few years, there are still many disparities in literacy. Students, female literacy remains much lower than male literacy all over India. Literacy among males is nearly 16.6% higher than females, and it is also about 16.1% higher in urban areas as compared to rural areas. Students, there is also wide variation in literacy rates from one region of the country to another. For example, there is about 94% literacy in Kerala but 62% in Bihar. Students, do you know, government has taken many steps towards providing elementary education to all. Some important steps are, the primary school system has expanded to over 7.68 lakh in 2004-2005 in India. Students, government's initiative of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan aims at providing elementary education to all children in the age group of 6 to 14 years. Students, it is a significant step towards providing elementary education to all children in the age group of 16 to 14 years in 2010. Students, what is the main aim of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan? Yes, it is a time-bound initiative of the central government in partnership with the states, the local government, and the community for achieving the goals of universalization of elementary education. Midday meal scheme has been implemented to encourage attendance and retention of school children and improve their nutritional status. Students, retention means control of something. That means midday meal scheme has been launched by the government in schools to encourage attention and retention of children and to improve their nutritional status. Students, over the past 50 years, there has been a significant growth in the number of universities and institutions of higher learning in specialized areas. Students, the 11th five-year plan endeavored to increase the enrollment in higher education of the 18 to 23 years age group to 15% by 2011 to 2012 and to 21% by the 12th five-year plan. Students, endeavored means try hard to do. Students, the strategy focuses on increasing access, quality, adoption of states, specific curriculum modification, vocationalization, and network on the use of information technology. Students, the plan also focuses on distance education as well as convergence of formal, non-formal, distant and IT education institutions. Students, do you know what are the strategies adopted in the 11th plan for education and literacy? The strategies include increasing access, quality, adoption of states, specific curriculum modification, vocationalization, and networking on the use of information technology. Isn't it? Yes. It is also focused on convergence of formal, non-formal, distant and IT education institutions. Moving on to understand health. Health means ability to remain free of illness and injuries. Isn't it? Students, the health of a person helps him to realize his potential and the ability to fight illness. That means proper healthcare helps a person to realize his potential and ability to fight illness. So, the government's national policy on health aims at improving the access to healthcare, family welfare, and nutritional services. Students, over the last 5 decades, India has built up a vast health infrastructure and has developed manpower required at primary, secondary, and tertiary sector in government as well as in the private sector. Students, during the last 50 years, India has built up a vast healthcare manpower and infrastructure. Students, what do you mean by health? Yes, health means ability to remain free of illness and injuries. And to understand life expectancy, infant mortality rate, birth rate and death rate. At first, we will discuss about life expectancy. Students, life expectancy means the average period that a person may expect to live. Students, life expectancy is the number of years that an average person can expect to live, calculated according to existing data for the particular region. Students, do you know life expectancy has increased to over 66 years in the year 2011 from 26 years at the time of independence? Students, do you know what is life expectancy? Yes, life expectancy is the number of years an average person can expect to live based on data. Students, these measures adopted have increased the life expectancy to over 67.5 years in 2013. Students, now we will discuss about infant mortality rate. Students, infant mortality rate means the death rate during the first year of life. Students, infant mortality rate has come down to 42 infants per 1,000 live births in the year 2012. From 147 in the year 1951. Students, what do you mean by infant mortality rate? Yes, infant mortality rate means the death rate during the first year of life. Let us discuss about birth rate and death rate. Students, birth rate is a statistic that measures the number of live births per 1,000 people. Death rate is a statistic that measures the number of deaths per 1,000 people. Students, crude birth rates have dropped to 21.4 and death rates to 7 within the same duration of time. That means, crude birth rate has dropped to 21.1 from 40.8 earlier and crude death rate to 7 from 25.1 earlier. Students, increase in life expectancy and improvement in childcare are useful in assessing the future progress of the country. Students, what is infant mortality rate? Yes, the infant mortality rate refers to the number of deaths of infants per 1,000 live births before completing 1 year. Students, differentiate between birth rate and death rate. Yes, the birth rate is the total number of live births per 1,000 people during a particular period of time. Students, the death rate is the total number of deaths per 1,000 people during a particular period of time. This is the difference between birth rate and death rate. Moving on to understand unemployment. Students, unemployment means it is a situation when people who are willing to work at the existing wages are not able to find jobs for themselves. Students, unemployment exists when people who are willing to work at the going wages cannot find jobs. Listen to it. Students, the workforce includes all people from the age of 15 years to 59 years. Children and elderly people are not included in workforce, so are not be considered as unemployed. Students, in the case of India, we have unemployment in rural and urban areas. However, the nature of unemployment differs in rural and urban areas. Students, the different types of unemployment found in India are seasonal unemployment, disguised unemployment, educated unemployment. Students, in rural areas, there is seasonal and disguised unemployment. Urban areas have mostly educated unemployment. Let us discuss about seasonal unemployment. Students, it is a situation when people are not able to find jobs During the particular months of a year, especially in agriculture. Students, it happens when people are not able to find jobs during some months of the year. For example, people dependent upon agriculture. Students, there are certain busy seasons when sowing, harvesting, weeding and threshing is done, isn't it? Yes. Certain months do not provide much work to the people dependent on agriculture. Seasonal unemployment occurs when workers can find work in a specific season. For example, agricultural workers may find work only during busy agricultural seasons when sowing, harvesting, weeding and threshing are done. Students, what is meant by seasonal unemployment? Yes, it is a situation when people are not able to find jobs during the particular months of a year, especially in agriculture. Moving on to understand disguised unemployment. Students, disguised unemployment means it is a situation when people appear to be employed, but in reality, they are not, such as in agriculture. If 5 people are working, but only 3 are required, then 2 people are disguised unemployed. That means, in the case of disguised unemployment, people appear to be employed. Listen to it. Yes. They have agricultural plot where they find work. This usually happens among family members engaged in agricultural activity. The work requires the service of 5 people but engages 8 people. 3 people are extra, isn't it? Yes. These 3 people also work in the same plant as the others. The contribution made by the 3 extra people does not add to the contribution made by the 5 people. If 3 people are removed, the productivity of the field will not decline. The field requires the service of the 5 people and the 3 extra people are disguised unemployed. Students, disguised unemployment means when all the people appear to be employed, but the work requires less number of persons, the unemployment is disguised. For example, a small farmer's entire family is working on his plot, although all may not be required to do so. Let us discuss about educated unemployment. Students, educated unemployment means unemployment among the educated people. It usually occurs in cities where there are educated or skilled people but no job opportunities. Students, in urban areas, many young people with matriculation, graduation and post-graduation degrees are not able to find jobs. Listen to it. Yes. This situation leads to educated unemployment. Students, a study showed that unemployment of graduate and postgraduate has increased faster than among matriculates. Students, a paradoxical manpower situation is observed when surplus of manpower in certain categories coexists with shortage of manpower in others. Students, what is educated unemployment? Yes, it means unemployment among the educated people. It usually occurs in cities where there are educated or skilled people but no job opportunities. Moving on to understand effects of unemployment. Students, unemployment has a harmful impact on the overall growth of an economy. Increase in unemployment is an indicator of a depressed economy. Students, it also wastes the resource which could have been gainfully employed. The 2 consequences of unemployment are, it leads to wastage of manpower resources. It tends to increase in economic overload. Students, consequences means a result. Students, unemployment affects the economy in the following ways. At first, unemployment leads to the wastage of manpower resource. See, people who can be an asset for the economy turn into a liability. Students, feeling of hopelessness and despair occurs among the youth. People do not have enough money to support their family. Inability of educated people willing to work to find gainful employment implies a great social waste. Students' unemployment tends to increase economic overload. See, the dependence of the unemployment on the working population increases. The quality of life of an individual as well as of society is adversely affected. See, there is a general decline in health status and rising withdrawal from the school system. Students, do you know unemployment rate is low in India? Why? Yes, in India, the unemployment rate is low because large number of people with low income and productivity are counted as employed. Moving on to understand labor absorbing sectors of economy. Students, do you know agriculture is the most labor absorbing sector of the economy? But employment in this sector has declined because of disguised unemployment. Students, the surplus people have moved to work in the secondary and tertiary sectors. Small scale manufacturing absorbs most of the labor in the secondary sector. New employment opportunities are emerging in the tertiary sector in IT, biotechnology, call centers and other service areas. Students, what does increase in unemployment indicate? Yes, increase in unemployment indicates a depressed economy. If people cannot be used as a resource, they naturally appear as a liability to the economy. Students, mention two consequences of unemployment. Yes, it leads to wastage of manpower resources. It tends to increase in economic overload. Students, mention the two types of unemployment found in the rural India. Yes, seasonal unemployment and disguised unemployment. Students, now I am going to revise human resource, primary sector, secondary sector, tertiary sector, and economic activities. Let us discuss about human resource. Students, human beings who are healthy, educated, and mentally strong can prove to be useful for a country or community and are treated as resources themselves, called human resources. Moving on to understand primary sector, secondary sector, tertiary sector, and economic activities. Students, you know, people have been engaged in various activities. Students, activities that add value to the national income are termed as economic activities. That means the activities which help to earn money for the country or add value to the national income are known as economic activities. Students, the three sectors of economic activities are primary sector, secondary sector, and tertiary sector. At first, I am going to revise primary sector. Students, activities which involve direct extraction and production of natural resources are called primary activities. Primary activities include agriculture, forestry, animal husbandry, mining, quarrying, and poultry farming, etc. Moving on to understand secondary sector. Students, using products resulting from activities in the primary sector for manufacturing of finished goods are classified in this category. Students, all manufacturing processes and construction activities are included in the secondary sector. Let us discuss about tertiary sector. Students, all activities which support the primary and secondary sectors are classified in this category. These include trade, transportation, communication, sales and services, education, health, tourism, banking, insurance, legal services, government, etc. Let us recall market activities and non-market activities. Students, economic activities have two parts, market activities and non-market activities. Market activities are those activities for which the people who perform these activities are paid or have profits such as production of goods and services. Students, market activities involve remuneration to anyone who performs. For example, activity performed for pay or profit. Students, non-market activities are those activities which are carried out for self-consumption, such as consumption and processing of primary products and own account production of fixed assets. For example, women doing domestic work, looking after children are non-market activities, while men working in the fields earning money, which they spent on rearing their families are market activities. Students, this division of labor between men and women in families is due to historical and cultural reasons. Students, what are economic activities? Yes, the activities which help to earn money for the country or add value to the national income are known as economic activities. Listen to it. Students, what do you mean by market activities? Yes, market activities are those activities for which the people who perform these activities are paid or have profits such as production of goods and services. Students, now I am going to revise birth rate, death rate, unemployment, Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Let us discuss about birth rate. Students, the birth rate is the total number of live births per 1000 people during a particular period of time. Students, birth rate is the number of babies born there for every 1000 people during a particular period of time. Let us discuss about death rate. Students, the death rate is the total number of people dying per 1000 people during a particular period of time. Death rate is the number of people per 1000 who die during a particular period of time. And to understand unemployment. Students, unemployment means it is a situation when people who are willing to work at the existing wages are not able to find jobs for themselves. Students, unemployment exists when people who are willing to work at the going wages cannot find jobs. Students, in the case of India, there is unemployment in both rural and urban areas. See, in rural areas, there is seasonal and disguised unemployment. Urban areas have mostly educated unemployment. Students, what is meant by seasonal unemployment? Yes, it is a situation when people are not able to find jobs during the particular months of a year, especially in agriculture. Students, do you know what is disguised unemployment? Yes, it is a situation when people appear to be employed, but in reality, there are not such as in agriculture. See, if 5 people are working but only 3 are required, then 2 people are disguised unemployed. Students, can you tell what is educated unemployment? Yes, it means unemployment among the educated people. Am I right? Yes, it usually occurs in cities where there are educated or skilled people but no job opportunities. Moving on to understand Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Students, it is a significant step towards providing elementary education to all children in the age group of 6 to 14 years in 2010. Students, it is a time-bound initiative of the central government in partnership with the states, the local government, and the community for achieving the goals of universalization of elementary education. Students, what do you know about Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan? Yes, it is a significant step towards providing elementary education to all children in the age group of 6 to 14 years in 2010. Students, it is a time-bound initiative of the central government in partnership with the states, the local government, and the community of achieving the goal of universalization of elementary education. Students, when does population becomes human capital? Yes, population becomes human capital when investment is made in the form of education, training, and medical care. Listen to it. Yes, It adds up to the productive power of a country. Students, do you know which factor decides the growth rate of a country? Yes, the growth rate of a country is decided by the quality of population. Students, what are Navodaya Vidyalayas? Yes, Navodaya Vidyalayas are the schools started for the talented children in the rural areas. Thank you.